Hi, thank you for taking the time to come and join us as we study God's Word. You know, God's Word is so important, especially for these last days, the end times here, that we really got to make sure we know the truth of the Word so that we cannot be deceived or be mistaken. Having said that, our subject for tonight is, can holiness be obtained? I think that's very important as we're going to dig into the Word of God and allow the Bible to interpret itself and to teach us what the truth really is behind holiness. Can man attain holiness or can we not? But the Bible is really clear. I think that's a big difference here, is that let's see what the Bible tells us about holiness and our ability to achieve that, to attain that. Having said that, I invite you to bow your heads with me as we open up in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this gorgeous night, Lord, the welcoming of the Sabbath. Father, we pray for your guidance, and we pray that you'll open up our minds and our hearts, Father, to receive the truth and to welcome this lesson. It's grounded from your word, and Father, that it'll be a blessing and will nourish our spirituality. Father, we lift this prayer in the blessed name of Jesus. Amen. So again, our subject is, can holiness be attained? You know, we live in a time, a society where the truth is all relative, right? It's no longer black or white. It's not left or right. Sometimes it's both ways, especially in, like I said, this society where things are so up and down and so gray. It's no longer straightforward. It's no longer black and blue or black and white. And you know, unfortunately, the Word of God has been controverted that that's no longer the case. You know, we live in a time where it is now common for people to believe that holiness is not attainable. Holiness is nothing for the Christian to achieve because it's unachievable. And that's, you know, I think that is such a misfortune because that's not what the Bible teaches. And I invite you to have an open mind and open your Bibles as we study together and we really learn what it takes to really get a deep and true grasp of what the Bible teaches regarding holiness. You know, when Satan came, if we go back to Genesis, Satan came and really the first deception was a cunning, very, shall we say, slick, a way that he twisted the truth of God's words and made it so similar to what he was trying to achieve that Eve couldn't quite decipher. And not to mention threw a little bone at it to twist it and make it seem like, well, if Eve did such and such, if she grabbed hold of the fruit and ate it, she would have infinite wisdom. She would be like God. And that's, you know, that's where the truth and the lie comes and it merges, and that's where the deception is that if we're not careful, the lie will sound so much like the truth that we would be mistaken. So let's do that and read from Genesis here, chapter 2, verse 16 and 17. And let's read what God said to, God spoke to Adam and Eve, and he said, "And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat, you shall surely die." So God made it really clear to both of them that you're free to roam around and to explore and to enjoy this garden, this paradise. But there's one tree where you cannot eat. And you shall not, or else you will surely die. So it is a clear commandment. It is a clear pronunciation that God gave unto Eve. And she didn't pay close attention to what God was instructing her. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 1 and 4, it reads, "Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, 'Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?' Then the serpent said to the woman, 'You shall not surely die.'" You see, if we compare those two phrases, and it's highlighted in red, you will see that there is just a slight variance between the two. God says, "You shall surely die." And what did the serpent, or what did Satan say? "You shall not surely die." It's almost identical, but that word "not" changes the whole conversation of what the meaning is behind that phrase. And you see that's the deception, is that it sounds so similar to the truth, but that's exactly what Satan is. He is a cunning liar, and because of that, guess what happened? Both Eve and Adam ate from the fruit, and they fell from grace. And there lies the first separation, the major separation between how God intended for humanity, their relationship with God, and how man has fallen from grace, has now taken on sin, and is therefore full of sin. And that's why we need redemption. But you see, the truth is that people have also been misguided too. Not only then, but the same thing is still happening in our same day and age. You see, people are misguided, or has not been really studying the Bible, and has been relying on their pastors or theologians to teach them, instead of relying on the guidance of the Holy Spirit in reading the Word. And that's where we've made the mistake. But let's understand what the deception is. You know, a lot of people in our time, they said that holiness can't be achieved. That's something that we can't obtain. We can't reach for, because there's a great divide that we just can't reach. And to some degree, I do agree with that. But there's more, right? Because Jesus didn't come to die on the cross to give us didn't empower us to overcome sin. You know, we call ourselves Christians. We live a life like Christ. And we see that Christ came and demonstrated, lived a life that was sinless, that was pure and holy. Likewise, as Christians, we need to put Jesus Christ as our example, and we need to live like him. So if he lived a life that is holy, even the most common sense or a common child can understand that, well, if Jesus did such and such as a Christian, we should be able to, or we should live to achieve the same thing. Going on, you know, people say that God's grace is good enough. Well, allow Jesus Christ to come and die on the cross, and that's enough. His grace is sufficient. And I am good the way I am, a simple person. I just got to ask for forgiveness every time and not change. I think that's the key piece. It's not changing, not allowing ourselves to be changed, not allowing the faith that we've accepted to change us, to change who we are. And then some people say, well, you know, no one's perfect. We can't change. We live in sin. Our body is full of sin. And like I said, to a degree, these statements are true, but we have to go further. We have to take it much further, because Jesus Christ didn't come to not empower us. He came to give us victory over sin. And how are we going to have victory over sin when we have mastered sin? When sin is no longer a part of our life, then we can attain holiness. You know, this picture here depicts one who is really coming into the life of baptism. And when this Christian, this person, who at first is full of mud, which represents sin, and then through baptism, And after baptism, this person looks no different from when he or she was. And that isn't the life of a Christian. God empowers us. And when we are baptized, we have died to our old life, the life of sin, and we are raised back up again in newness of life. You see that we are completely transformed. We are renewed. We are a new creation in Christ Jesus. We cannot be like the old man. We cannot continually go in this cycle without achieving anything. And that's really what the scope of, or the truth of the Bible, that's really what it's teaching us, is that we've got to die to our old self. We've got to move on. And we've got to be changed. And yes, yes, no doubt, holiness can be attained. Because Jesus Christ lived the perfect example for us. He has attained it. And he has given us the victory over sin to obtain it. Let's read on, you know, and let's understand. So who then is holy, right? Who is holy? You know, only God is holy. We know that for certain, that God is the only one that is holy. But if God is holy and we are his sons and daughters, can we achieve that? You know, let's read what the Bible says about who has holiness. What is holiness? In 1 Samuel 2:2 it says, "No one is holy like the Lord, for there is none beside you." You see, the Lord God alone is holy. We know that. So that is crystal clear that God alone has holiness. But you see, that is a snapshot of what God is and what God will ultimately be and what God will continually be, excuse me. But what about you and me? Can we get the same thing? Can we receive the same? As we just saw, Isaiah 6:3 says, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." God alone is holy. Holy, holy, holy. He is holy. The Father is holy. The Son is holy. And the Holy Spirit is holy. So we know that that is clear. But what about you and I, right? Do we have that chance? But in Psalms 89:34 says, "Once I've sworn by my holiness," God declares, "I will not lie to David." It's crystal clear that the Bible teaches that God alone is holy, but there's more to it. There is more, because if that was the case, if God was the only one that is holy, and we cannot obtain holiness through the blood of Jesus Christ. So let's be crystal clear here, is that we cannot obtain holiness by ourselves, but by the blood of Jesus Christ, by us living a life, by us allowing the Holy Spirit to empower us to live this life, then we can live a life that is a new creation, created in Christ Jesus. So what is the plan of salvation? What is the purpose of Jesus Christ dying on the cross? Did he die just to demonstrate his goodness, his holiness, and that's it? No, to, as I mentioned already, to give us victory over sin. You know, in 2 Corinthians 5:21 it says, "For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." You see, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. The original Hebrew says it's clear in that we might receive the righteousness of God. That's what that the root meaning means, that we can achieve righteousness or holiness like God himself. That's the plan of salvation. Because if there isn't an opportunity, if there isn't a chance for us to receive holiness or to obtain holiness, then the death of Christ on the cross would have been in vain. Then how can we be in the presence of God? Remember when Moses went to the mountain and God says, "Take off your shoes, for the ground you are stepping on is holy ground." And in addition, Moses said, "God, I want to see your glory. I want to see your face." And God says, "Nobody can see God. No man can see the face of God, lest he die. Why? Because we are full of sin, and our corruption will kill us in the presence of the goodness and the holiness of God. So there is a chance for us to allow the blood of Jesus Christ to work in us so that we can be made pure. And we are then not only justified, but we are then continually allowing ourselves to be sanctified so that we may be in the presence of God. That's the plan of salvation. In Galatians 2:16, it says, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Christ Jesus, that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified. Wait, doesn't that sound confusing? But let's allow the Bible to interpret itself. Let me give another verse, and then we can go back and try to figure this out and see what the Bible is meaning. In Romans 2, verse 13, it also says, for not the hearers of the law are just in the sight of God, but the doers of the law will be justified. So by faith, we are justified, but also not just our faith alone, but one who does the law, who acts out, who lives out his faith. You see, in Galatians 2:16, it talks about who we are in our personal life. If we're trying to attain righteousness by our own selves, we can't. That's what it's saying. But by faith and by the works of our faith, we live it out, then we are justified. It is the life before Jesus Christ with the blood and the Holy Spirit. It empowers us to live a life of sanctification, and then we are justified. And then it is the whole picture of God's grace, his salvific work at the cross, and then the newness of life when we've died to our old self and been resurrected into a newness of life. We are made new, and we continue to live the life that the Holy Spirit empowers us to live. That's when we really can proclaim the justification of Jesus Christ. That is really the keeping of the law, the Ten Commandments. When we can keep that, we can live it in its fullness. Then we can glorify God and show that what I used to be, a wicked, sinful person, but now by the blood of Jesus Christ, by my faith in his salvific word, and in the fruits of the Holy Spirit allowing me to be changed and be sanctified, I can therefore be like Jesus Christ. I can therefore be holy like he is holy. We'll get to that, but that's really the concept here. But let's allow the Bible to give us more verse where it can maybe help reassure us why this is true. In Romans 3:31 it says, do we make void the law through faith? Certainly not. On the contrary, we establish the law. You see, Romans 3:31 here supports what we just read, in that our faith alone is not sufficient. On the contrary, it says, we establish, we uphold, we live out the law when we are made new again. That is the life that Jesus Christ wants us to live, a victory over sin that we can proclaim, and we can then profess, and not only profess, but be like sons and daughters of God, who is righteous, holy, and good. And then we can be just like so. Additionally, Romans 6:15 and 18 reads, what then? Shall we sin because we are not under law but under grace? Certainly not. And verse 18 goes on to say, and having been set free from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. You see, we are set free from sin. We are no longer slaves to it. Remember when the Israelites were slaved in Egypt? They've been slaved and there's no way out, but God gave them a way. And through that, through the work of Moses, God allowed them to be freed to live a life of newness, Or as verse 18 says, to be slaves of righteousness. If you are a slave to righteousness, that means that you are in total obedience. A slave is one who works and who obeys their master. And in this case, who is our master? Righteousness. You see, when we submit and we completely give in to the righteousness, the holiness, the goodness of God, that means that we are working towards that. Not, again, not by our own selves, because we can't do it in our own bodies, but by the power of the Holy Spirit, by the blood of Jesus Christ, we can achieve that. 2 Corinthians 7:1 says, therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Amen. Isn't that powerful? Isn't that true? It says, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness, all sin, all wickedness, everything that you used to be, the lies, the stealing, the murders, the slander, the gossip. You know, all the bad stuff that you did that separated you from God, that is now gone away with. It's washed away by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, the key piece is we got to perfect the holiness of God by fearing Him. Perfected. What does perfecting holiness mean? It is a word to define the works that we must do. And in other words, sanctification. Sanctification doesn't come to us. Grace comes to us. Faith comes to us. Sanctification is the allowing the works to come out of us, to show the fruits of the Spirit. That is what that means, is that we gotta, now that we've received Jesus Christ by faith and through His grace, we then allow God to work in us, perfecting that holiness. And when we have perfected holiness, guess what? We can be holy just like He is holy. Isn't that powerful? Isn't that profound? You know, that's what the Bible teaches. Contrary to what man teaches, what theologians, what schools, universities, pastor teaches, that's not biblical. The Word of God is crystal clear. We've gone through some verses, and that is as clear as it gets. Brothers and sisters, I encourage you to allow the Holy Spirit to work in you. You know, when I've received the truth here, when I started digging for the truth and really start appreciating that God gives me the power to change and no longer live a life of sin, I tell you what, my life has been completely different. I used to go to church years and years and years ago and not change. You know, I used to go to church and still smoke weed and still lie and still drink and still party and still very much like the world. Nothing has changed except on Sunday, I go to church and I profess to be a Christian. But after church is done, I'm no different. My life is not different. The fruits are not there. But you see, when I proclaim the Word of God, when I see the words of God being as clear as the passages that we just read, and I take hold of it, and as James 2:10 says, you know, if we break one, we're guilty of breaking all the sins. You know, when we do that, then we've fallen short. But you see, this verse in 1 Thessalonians 4:7-8 says, for God did not call us to uncleanliness, but in holiness. Therefore, he who rejects this does not reject man, but God, who has also given us his Holy Spirit. So he has given us his Holy Spirit to do what? To live a life of holiness. You see, if we claim to have the Holy Spirit within us, and he is holy, guess what the Bible also says about us? Our body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. Can a holiness or can the Holy Spirit live within us if we're filthy and we're full of sin? Not a chance, brothers and sisters. You see, it works in that His holiness can only be in a temple or in a body that is holiness. If we are holy, then we can have the Holy Spirit within us. But if we are full of sin and our life is not changed, we cannot have the Holy Spirit. It's that simple. Why do you think during Pentecost, the disciples were full of the Holy Spirit and they did miracles and works? Because they've allowed themselves, their old selves, to die and to be purified, to be made new, and then they receive the Holy Spirit. You and I likewise need to be changed and allow ourselves to be sanctified, to be made new, to be sinless. If we continue to work at it, just like if you were, for example, if you were somebody that swore a lot, how do you overcome that? By first praying to God and allowing Him to work in you, to give you a new heart, not a heart of stone, but a heart of flesh. And then perfecting that, practicing that, praying and asking forgiveness as you fall, but you allow the Holy Spirit to change you, allow God to work in you. And I can tell you, it's attainable. Every single sin can be mastered if we allow God to work in us. You know, in 1 Peter 2:9 it says, "But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation." We are a chosen people, brothers and sisters. Chosen. God has chosen you and I to be a royal priesthood. What is a priest? A priest is one who stands and does the work for God, for His people, or for the people. And then we are a holy nation. How can we be full of sin and be part of a holy nation? We can't. God's word is clear. We have to attain it. Brothers and sisters, don't believe the lie that Satan has put out there, or that people have said that we cannot achieve holiness until Jesus Christ comes back. If we hold on to that false doctrine, we would fall short. Because when Jesus Christ comes back, the word of God says He will bring with Him the reward for us. What reward would we have if we are still full of sin, if we are unchanged, if we are still full of wickedness and filthiness? Jesus would say, "Away from me, you who practice lawlessness, you who continually to break the law, you who are not like my sons and daughters." You see, we have this opportunity to get ourselves right by allowing God to work in us, to be changed, and to continually perfect ourselves, so that we can be ready. When He comes, our reward will come with Jesus Christ. And then we can accept, we can be accepted into the family of God, because we can proclaim to the world that God gives us victory over sin, and we have overcome the world and overcome the sins of this world. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15 and 19, it goes on to say, "But He who called you is holy, you also be holy in all of your conduct, because it is written, 'Be holy, for I am holy.' Conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in fear, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, but with the precious blood of Jesus Christ." That's exactly what we've been talking about. You see, the Bible is very clear, isn't it? I mean, let's allow the Bible to interpret itself and to teach us. It says that we are holy. Why? Because God was holy. And then if He is holy, then we ought to be holy in all of our conduct, it says in verse 15 there. In all of our conduct. That means everything you do, you say, your acts. Every time that you go out and you live out your life, whether that's at work, at school, you go grocery shopping, you're at home with your family, your conduct has to be holy. Just like Jesus. The Pharisees tried to discredit Jesus as much as they can, but they cannot. They had people lying to try to refute Jesus, that He was a sinful man, but they knew that's just wickedness. That's not true. Jesus lived a life of purity, of holiness. We too can live that. And it goes on to say that we need to conduct ourselves through the time. Conduct ourselves. We need to live it out. We need to practice it. Practice holiness. Again, verse 16 is so powerful. 1 Peter 1:16 says, "Be holy, for I am holy." That is a command, brothers and sisters, that we need to be holy just as He is holy. So powerful, so true. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. We need to be holy, for He is holy. Because He has given us the blood. The precious blood of Jesus Christ allows us to be redeemed, not by the corruptible things, but by the precious blood of Jesus Christ through the Spirit of God. That's how we can overcome. You know, Revelations chapter 20, verse 6, it says, "Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such the second death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. You know, this is talking about God's people who allows themselves to be sanctified and then holy. These are the people who has taken or who can be partakers of the first resurrection. You know, the Bible teaches that those God's people are the one that will be resurrected the first time around. The second resurrection is a resurrection of the dead, and they have no hope. They have no chance of salvation. So God's people are the holy people who will be resurrected when Jesus comes again the second time. The Bible is really clear. We have to be holiness. If by that point we're not holy, we're not pure, just like Jesus Christ is, our chance is over. That's it. Probation has closed. It's too late for us. Let's allow the book of Revelations to uncover us, because it is the revelations. The book of Revelations is the revelations of Jesus Christ. Jesus is revealing his character, who he is, the end coming. And we've got to read this book and understand. In Revelations chapter 14, verse 1 and verse 5, it says, "Then I looked, and behold, a lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written on their foreheads, and in the mouths," verse 5 says, "and in the mouths was found no deceit, for they are without fault before the throne of God." So if a person, so these 144,000 are God's chosen people at the end time. And these people have the Father's name written on their foreheads. What do you think this means? If you are a Bible student, a prophetic Bible student, you would know that the name of Jesus represents his character, who he is, and his law. You see, these people are the ones who has a characteristic of Jesus Christ, his holiness, his goodness, and his law on their foreheads. So what's on their foreheads? Their thought process. They know, and not only do they know, they live it out. They pursue that. These are people who are without sin. How are we assured of that? Verse 5 says that they, in their mouths are found no deceit, and they're without fault. You see, if there's no deceit found in their mouths and they're without fault, that means they're holy. They're pure, just like God is. You know, that verse is so powerful. Let's look at another verse that talks about who has no deceit in their mouths. Let's read that. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21 and 22, it reads, "That you should follow his steps, who committed no sin, nor was deceit found in his mouth." His, you see here, has a capital H here, which is referring to Jesus. So it says that Jesus committed no sin, nor was there no deceit found in his mouth. You see the correlation between the two verses? Jesus was sinless, was pure, and there was no deceit found in his mouth. Likewise, the 144,000, God's chosen people, in the end times will be like him, exactly like him, will be sinless and will have no deceit found within them. The Bible is very clear, brothers and sisters. If you're hearing this for the first time, please allow the Word of God to change you, to perfect His holiness in your life, so that we can stop living a life of sin, so that we can truly have victory over sin, so that we can stop sinning. Because sin is what separates us from God. Sin is what destroys us. Sin is what kills us. And that's exactly the purpose of Jesus Christ dying on the cross, to give us victory over sin. So we must overcome. We must be holy, just like he is holy. Revelations chapter 22, verse 11 goes on to say, "He who is unjust, let him be unjust still. He who is filthy, let him be filthy still. Here's the key point. He who is righteous, let him be righteous still. He who is holy, let him be holy still. You know, we talked about probation closing, the time of Jesus' second coming. This is when this Bible verse here, chapter 22, verse 11, comes true. When a time is coming, just like a person that stands before a judge, at that point, your sin, your life, your record is now uncovered, and the judge makes a determination or a decision based upon the actions and the deeds that a person committed or did. Likewise, when we stand before God at the judgment seat, this is the point where if you are unjust, you will remain unjust. If you are filthy, you will be filthy. If you are a sinful person, you will remain sinful. Because when you're standing before the judgment, the chance is it. There's no more. No more chances for you to say, well, let me perfect my character. It's too late. This is your chance. This is your chance and my chance to hear the word of God and allow God to empower us, to work in us so that we can be pure. And as it goes on to say, he who is righteous, let him be righteous still. Still. Then if you are righteous, then you will remain righteous. If he who is holy, let him be holy still. If we are righteous and holy at that time, we will remain likewise, because God will come and wash away the sins of this world, and he will create all things new, the Bible says. And then sin will have no place in this world. Then we will have total victory over sin, and we will live a life that is pure, holy, and righteous. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14 also reads, pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see God. You see, the peace, the critical piece here is that without holiness, no one can see God. No one can see the Lord. If you call yourselves a Christian, brothers and sisters, this is a very sober message. If you are a Christian, and you want to have a chance to allow the salvific work to be completed in your life, and you want to have a chance to meet the Lord, you've got to allow holiness to be perfected in you. Otherwise, you will not see the Lord. And if you did, the sin will destroy you. Only through the holiness. Why do you think the holy angels are able to stand in the presence of God? Because they are holy. We, likewise, if we allow ourselves to be purified, to be sanctified, then we can stand in the presence of God. You know, in Revelation chapter 22, verse 14, it says, blessed are they that do his commandment, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. Into what gate? The gates of the New Jerusalem. We will have a chance. But if we keep the commandments, we allow God to empower us, to purify us, and to change us. Sanctification is a key component here. We are justified by the blood of Jesus Christ, by the grace of God. But that's only a one part out of the two-part fold. We have to allow the second part to come and to be made full in our lives, which is the sanctification part. The Bible is clear. Don't let people misguide you or teach you anything other than what the Word of God teaches. We, if we want to have a chance, if we want it to be in the presence of God, we've got to allow ourselves to be perfected, to pursue holiness, and be holy, for he is holy, 1 Peter 1:16 says. So I hope this message is thought-provoking. I hope this message really opens your eyes to see something that maybe you've never heard before. But brothers and sisters, if you are a Christian, study the verses that we just went through and read it for yourself and know that God wants us to be like him, to be holy like him. That is how we can be true sons and daughters of the living God, who is holy, righteous, and good, and therefore we can be likewise. Let's end it with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your truth, for your word. Father, we pray that your truth that justifies us will also sanctify us and change us and make us pure and holy as you are holy, Father, so that we can have part in the everlasting life, just as you have made Adam and Eve to be holy, to be right, to be without sin. That you will make all things new again, and we will have the same communion once again if we allow ourselves to be sanctified. Father, we pray for your blessing. We pray for your truth to be empowered within our lives. We lift this prayer in the blessed name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you for your time. Hopefully you'll come and join with us as we study more about God's Word. Thank you.